Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's try one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
Very good. Yes, we got to get our spirits up on this dark, gray, rainy Sunday morning. Welcome to the First Congregational Church of Boylston. To all who are weary and in need of rest, you are welcome here. To all who are hurting and need comfort, you are welcome here. To all who are anxious and in need of peace, you are welcome here. To all who are broken and in need of wholeness, you are welcome here. To all the spiritually curious searching for answers to life's biggest questions, you are welcome here. And to all those who need to hear the good news of what God has done through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, you are welcome here. My name is Fred Simler, and I am the worship leader today. If you're new to our church, we want to thank you for being here. We're honored to have you with us, and we would love to get to know you better. You'll find a welcome card in the back of the pew in front of you, and we would love for you to fill out the card and place it in the offering plate up here to my left, up front, or in the back of the sanctuary. Our flowers today on the altar are given to the glory of God and a happy heavenly 49th wedding anniversary to Roz's beloved Bill Franzen. You're greatly missed. Love, Roz. Very nice. In recognition of Veterans Day, which just occurred here on Friday, 11/11, we'd like to take this moment to recognize and acknowledge those of you in the congregation who have sacrificed your time and efforts in support of our country. Could we have those of you who could stand as you are able, who are veterans, either formerly served or actively served? Thank you. You can be seated. Thank you for your service. It's greatly appreciated, especially when we come to exercise our freedom of speech or freedom of religion. Just the fact that we're able to congregate here today, we owe you all a great debt. Want to recognize yesterday in the church we had our craft fair. It was very successful, so I wanted to thank all of those who not only brought treasures to the craft fair and worked the booths and the tables. I wanted to thank the youth group as well for all the goodies and treats, and thank those who baked for us, and everyone who made it a tremendous success. Also wanted to remind folks that our church is still in need of our funding, and if you haven't already filled out your pledge cards for 2023, please remember to do so. I think the deadline is next Sunday. So if you have your pledge cards, please fill them out. You can either put them in the office. I think that would probably be the best. And there's a little slot in the office door. If you could slide it into there, that would be fantastic. In additional announcements, with respect to our nursery, God was with us as he always is. And we have hired Deidre Langway to fill the position of nursery attendant. She's very qualified for this position and very easy to talk to. Deidre will be there this Sunday. She's down there, so if you want to, you can pop your head in and say hello. Additionally, today we have a church membership class, so if you're interested in membership, it is today, November 13th, and it's taking place after the service at 11:45. And then later this evening, you are all cordially invited to attend the installation service for Reverend Zach Stevenson, who is our 38th pastor of the First Congregational Church of Boylston, and that's happening this evening, November 13th at 5 p.m. here at the church. A message from Christian Outreach. During the month of November, the Board of Christian Outreach is collecting donations for the Boylston Food Pantry. Those donations can be placed in the container at the front of the sanctuary on Sundays or in the shopping cart that we have down in the foyer in the church entry during the week. So it's down there, it's right where you come in. You should see the shopping cart. It's very easily recognizable. And in the month where we remember to be thankful, let's be mindful of those who may need a little extra help during this season. Our community ecumenical Thanksgiving worship service that we hold with St. Mary's of the Hills and our church here, First Congregational, is going to be held on Sunday, November 20th at 5 p.m. And it's happening here this year. I know every other year we take turns. Well, we're hosting this year, and it's on Sunday, November 20th at 5 p.m. Please plan to join us for worship and giving thanks and celebrating with our brothers and sisters throughout the community. We are also providing refreshments, so there is a sign-up sheet down in the fellowship hall. So if you're interested in supporting that, please take the opportunity to sign up there. And as we are entering into Advent season, we are getting together on Saturday, November 26th at 10 a.m. to decorate the church. And we will also have refreshments following our decorating. We have a special message coming up next from our youth group. I know they had a great turnout last weekend and great weather for it when they went to Six Flags. But who's going to be coming up? We have Molly Simler and Rachel Moore.
Good morning. My name is Rachel, and although it might be a little early for us to be wearing Santa hats, we wanted to share some of the youth group's upcoming projects and events for the Christmas season. There are 22 members this year, and we have so many ideas that Miss Simler's head is spinning. The first thing we would like to tell you about is Caroling on the Common, which is a townwide event that will be taking place on Saturday, December 3rd at 7 p.m. After singing by candlelight, we will have complimentary cookies, cocoa, and coffee in the fellowship hall. We're hoping that people will be able to unplug for the night, enjoy each other's company, and celebrate the season of Jesus' birth. We are passing around some flyers for you to hang on your fridge as a reminder. Please spread the word to your friends and neighbors. Also, if you would like to help us and bake for the event, we would appreciate anything. We're hoping to be able to offer food and a warm beverage to everybody who attends. The youth group is also planning to bring back the Christmas pageant this year. I'm sure Miss Simler will give me a starring role, so you can look forward to seeing more of us on stage during the service on December 18th.
Good morning, my name's Molly Simler. This holiday season, the youth group will be collecting Christmas gifts and gift cards for Veterans Inc. Homeless Shelter in Worcester. We have been fundraising for this organization for the past 5 years because we love the work that they do to help the homeless veterans rebuild their lives. Many of the veterans suffer from PTSD, mental or physical injuries, or substance abuse. We would like to help give them some joy this holiday season, so we thought about what they could use for Christmas gifts. Please consider helping us to serve the veterans by donating toward the purchase of gifts or purchasing gifts on your own. We are passing out a list of items the shelter is looking for to give the veterans as presents this Christmas. As always, thank you for your continued support of the Boylston FCC Youth Group.
Great job, thank you. So, again, in the spirit of the season, we have Build Your Own Gingerbread House coming up, and that is taking place on Saturday, December 3rd from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. Bring your family and friends and decorate gingerbread houses. Supplies are provided and registration is recommended just so we can get an accurate head count. And there will also be a story time and a festive area for photos. In addition, caroling on the common. On Saturday, December 3rd, the youth group is sponsoring Boylston's Caroling on the Common at 7 p.m. and serving cookies and hot chocolate afterwards in the Fellowship Hall. And I think are some of the details captured on the handout. Good, so you should have those there. And the Stevenson family are hosting an open house. Make sure you wipe your feet because, you know, we just redid that. We want to be nice guests to the Stevenson family, so, you know, make sure you wipe your feet on your way in, especially if it's snowy or muddy. And that is taking place on Sunday, December 18th. And they're just right over there. It's number 4 Church Street, in case you go religiously by your GPS system. But it's right over there, next door neighbor. So you're invited to celebrate the joy of the season with us. Light refreshments will be served, and a small craft for the little ones will be provided. So please drop by anytime between 2 p.m. and 5 p.m. And that is Sunday, December 18th. I believe, lastly, just wanted to mention our prayer wall, which exists on our website. So if you've not seen or used the prayer wall request page, please go ahead and take a look. You simply go onto our website, which is www.fccboylston.org, and click on the ellipse in the upper right-hand corner, slide down to connect. And there you will find a place to ask for prayer requests or to view all of the existing prayer requests. So I think we have worked our way through all of the goings-on here in the church, which this is a tremendous blessing that we do have all of this activity. So we hope that at least some of you will be able to come out and participate in one or multiple of those events. So. Let's begin our service today with our call to worship. Yeah, please stand as you are able. Let us worship God. O come, let us sing to the Lord and shout with joy to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving, singing joyful songs of praise.
You may be seated.
With you that we are going to repeat Jesus' name above all names.
It seems that a couple of weeks ago when we did this, the singer who was up here leading you only had one verse, and they've given me all three now. So this morning, we will be able to sing this, Please Rise If You Are Able, and we'll do all three verses.
And indeed, that was beautiful. Thank you, Haley and Gigi, for leading us. If you could now join us in our prayer of invocation. Gracious God, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Fill it with all truth and all peace. Where it is corrupt, purify it. Where it is in error, direct it. Where anything is in amiss, reform it. Where it is right, strengthen it. Where it is in want, provide for it. Where it is divided, reunite it. For the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen. And let us be so bold to pray, to pray the way that Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Our next song, please stand as you are able. It is Well With My Soul. It's hymn number 705 in your blue hymnals, and it's verses 1, 3, and 4. 1, 3, and 4.
Thank you. You may be seated. Before we invite whichever kids would like to go to Sunday school this morning, 3 to 7th graders, or age 3 to 7th graders, let me just pray a prayer of blessing over you guys, and we'll invite you on your way to have so much fun. Lord, we thank you so much for the children who are part of this church, whom you have gathered here this morning, and whom are part of this family. We pray that as they go, that they would have fun, that they would learn more about who you are, and in doing so, learn more of who they are. That as they, from this early age, start learning the ways of you, Jesus, that you would bless them, that you would guard them, and you would keep them, and grow them into a mature faith of followers of you who make a legitimate difference in this world, bringing about hope and renewal, filled with your Spirit. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Amen. So we invite you guys to go with, here we go, Miss Dej and Cheryl. This time in our service, we are about to participate in what Martin Luther calls the necessity of the Christian life, where we confess our shortcomings. We confess very legitimately our sins. As we think about who God is, and we listen to that beautiful song, Holy Ground, who God is. And because of who God is, who we are, because of that, we should be brought to this awareness of our own selfishness, of our own greed, how we make decisions that are for our betterment, not the betterment of others, all too often, which is our natural state. And so I invite you at this time to pray this prayer of confession with me. We have erred and strayed. Missed the first line. Let's try again. Let's start over. Almighty and merciful God, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare those who confess their faults. Restore those who are penitent. According to your promises, declared to the world in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O merciful God, for his sake, that we may live a holy, just, and humble life, to the glory of your holy name. And hear the good news, that Jesus, the God-man, lived the perfect life in your place. Jesus, this God-man, died on the cross for your sins, for the guilt of the sins which we have sinned against others, and also for the shame we have taken on from the sins of others. And Jesus, the God-man, he rose from the dead. He defeated death and hell and sin. But whoever believes this good news, the gospel, is now and forever forgiven. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And in light of our forgiveness, I invite you to stand, and we're going to respond to this good news with this song this morning. It is a newer one, but that shouldn't stop you from trying. Yeah, stand and sing with us.
Our reading this morning comes from the book of Philippians, chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. It's Philippians chapter 4, 6 through 7. And I think Zach was feeling sorry for me for the number of announcements that I had to do, because this is a short one. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard our hearts, guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, church. So I realized that the batteries for this are dead. So give me 1 second. Is there a way you can mute this so I can unplug it and plug this one in?
Yep, hold on.
So we don't
think everyone deaf, yes.
Yeah.
Try that.
All right. Hold on, folks.
All right, can you hear me? See, some of you can, but see, some of you can't. And we love all people here. Those who can hear and those who cannot hear. We'll just go with it. I'll talk very loudly. Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm so glad.
This one's active.
Oh, you know what?
You want to switch it up?
Fred. Wow. That's why we have so many engineers in our church home. We need the brains. Okay, I'm so glad you are here this morning as we take this time out of our weeks, our months, to kind of carve out this space to worship God, to learn to be better followers of the way of Jesus, and a way of life, I believe, which really can be understood as living above anxiety. Now, if you're new here this morning, we're so glad and honored you are here, whether that's in person or online. And maybe you're here and you're not even sure what you think about God or the Bible or Jesus, and we want you to know that we are so glad you're here. This is a safe place for you to explore the historic Christian faith, to figure out what you think and believe. I believe with all my heart that Jesus, with arms spread wide, is welcoming you. He's welcoming your questions. He's welcoming your doubts, and he's offering you wholeness. He's offering, just like all of us, to put us back together and offer us a flourishing life as we follow the ways of Jesus. So also, I do want to just note this. If you are exploring the Christian faith and you don't have a Bible, we have some we want you to have. They're on the way out. So if you don't have a Bible, you need a Bible, please grab one. Those are our gift to you. But this morning, we're on week two of a 3-week series of talks that we're calling Above Anxiety. And I made this stipulation last week just to make sure we're all on the same page, except I've got to stay hunkered down. This will be new for me. I'm going to walk off. As we're talking about anxiety, we're not talking about clinical anxiety. This teaching series is not meant to replace a therapist, a good Christian counselor. It's not meant to replace a medication that some of us need for chemical imbalances and those type of things. As we're talking about anxiety in this series, we're talking about that kind of anxious worrying that affects everyone. Like, regardless of where you are in life, we've all experienced those times where our lives were legitimately defined by worry and anxiety. And so what I actually think, as we encounter the world of the Bible and encounter what God is doing to make us whole and put us back together, to essentially recreate our broken reality, we're offered a way to live, a way to see the world, a way to exist that really is above anxiety. Now, last week, we talked about our identity and how the first step of dealing with anxiety is to understand who we truly are. Not a self-constructed identity, which, you know, we try to construct these identities or however we view that. And so I work so hard in becoming whatever it is I want to be. Maybe it's my identity so wrapped up in my career or growing this nest egg. Thankfully, I don't know if you guys have been watching, stock market's going back up, so that's good. But still, so 2 weeks ago, that's where our identity is, and what happens? When things start, our identity starts to crumble, we spend all this time trying to construct and reconstruct who we think we are, and we're missing the whole time God, who we believe God, who created us, is telling us, no, this is who you truly are. And to live, the first step to live above anxiety, we have to understand our identity. And so we learned this, that if you believe the gospel, the good news of what God is doing through Jesus, we learned that your identity is this: you're a priest for the glory of God and the good of the world. And knowing our identity is important, because when we know who we are, then we know what to do. So part of my identity, right, is pastor. The only reason I'm here this morning talking about Jesus and the Bible is because of part of who I am. Who I am determines what I do. So if we understand that who we are in Christ is priests, we represent God to the world. As priests, we take the good news of hope and healing out into the brokenness, and we touch those people that the world has marginalized, and we love those people that the world has overlooked. We're priests. This is what we do. And so as priests, as followers of Jesus, what do we do when worry starts to overtake our hearts or weighs us down? Or what do we do? Like last week, we learned this in Proverbs, one of the most obvious Bible verses that there is, that worry weighs a person down. And I did not bring my bag of weights this morning because I was sore after last week's message, so I will not be carrying those around. But this worry, it weighs us down. And a lot of this worry, I think, points to the fact that many of us don't live into our identities. Essentially, we live as if we're this. We're functional atheists. We live as if there is no God. We live as if we don't at least believe the end of the story. So maybe you're not a Christian. You're like, I don't know what you're talking about. So as part of our faith, as part of Christians, what we believe about the Bible is that Jesus is coming back to make everything right, to unright every wrong, and to fix brokenness, and to eradicate sin once and for all, to rip the greed, literally to rip the hell out of our hearts and fill us with new life. He's going to make everything right. And as Christians, oftentimes we live in this constant state of worry and anxiety because we're living as if we don't believe the end of the story that we claim to believe. We're functional atheists. And so as Fred so marvelously read for us, though, we learn a few things. The Apostle Paul tells us as he writes this letter to the church in Philippi. And he gives us a few steps. So here's step one to living above anxiety, right here. Don't worry about anything. Huh. Well, that's interesting. Thanks, Paul. But you weren't in the hospital room when the doctor gave me my diagnosis. Well, thanks, Paul, but pretty sure you didn't have to just spend $1,000 to fill up your oil tank in the cellar. Thanks, Paul, but, and our lists could go on and on and on. Now, what's interesting, though, is as Paul writes this, don't worry about anything. And it's easy for me, and it's probably easy for you too, to add on all these, yeah, but Paul, you don't have this in your life, and you didn't have this in your life. And what's fascinating about Paul, so Paul was someone who was very much against the way of Jesus, against Christianity, and he's persecuting them. He's a good Jewish man, and these Jesus folks are really destroying his religion, so he's throwing them in jail. And Jesus meets him where he is, in his brokenness, and calls him to more. And Paul has an identity change. And then he goes around and he plants all these churches, these little communities of hope, people learning to follow the way of Jesus. And in doing so, though, Paul brags about his spiritual life to another church in a letter we have in the New Testament. And he talks about how he was stoned, how he was beaten. In the book of Acts, he's beaten and he's dragged out of the city and left for dead. And Paul gets back up and goes right back into the city. He knows what it's like to be hungry, he tells us. He knows what it's like to be in need. And so it's not like he didn't have anything to worry about. And so step one, he tells us this: don't worry about anything. Now, I don't know about you, but that seems like a big ask to me. And I think what we can at least learn from this, maybe you're holier than I am, but this imperative for me is like, okay, I don't know about this yet, Paul. But I think at this point, though, I think we can at least learn this, that worry should not define our lives. And yet all too often it does. I think we all know that worrying is not a key ingredient to living a flourishing life. And yet all too often we worry regularly. Now, the good news is Paul doesn't just leave us with this advice. Don't worry about anything. He adds the second piece of advice, which is this: pray about everything. Paul said, don't worry about anything, pray about everything. But let's be honest, is that our normal posture? No, we tend to worry about everything and pray about relatively little. Maybe that's the problem. Our natural posture is not the way God intends for us to live, which is true for just about everything in our lives. Naturally, I'm selfish and greedy. We're all fatally flawed, and we all live outside of God's intended way for us to flourish. So this should be no different. But you see, when we believe the gospel and we start to understand and lean into our new identity as priest for the benefit of the world and the glory of God, we see this new way to live, a life of prayer instead of worry. Now, when you think of prayer, what do you think of? You don't have to say it out loud, but just real quick, in your mind, what do you think of? Is it when something goes wrong and your first instinct is just to say, oh, God? Maybe you don't even believe in God. I don't know. But that's how we pray. Or maybe, you know, we have those moments, okay, God, if you're for real, here's what I need. Christmas is coming, right? Santa baby. And that's what we think of prayer. Let me pull out my wish list. Okay. And if I can check off all my stuff, then I'll be good. But what if we have prayer all wrong? And that's why worry defines us more than prayer does. Or maybe you're here and you actually know what prayer is. But I think we can all acknowledge that knowing what prayer is cognitively and being a person who prays first and foremost are two very separate things, right? I think a lot of times Christians, as we practice following the way of Jesus and we go to Sunday school and we go through confirmation and we can answer the catechism questions of here's what prayer is. But then when we really look at our lives, knowing what it is, juxtaposition with what we do, it's not quite the same thing if most of us are honest. I actually think that being a person of prayer as we follow Jesus is extremely difficult, especially in this cultural moment, our digital age. I mean, think about, when's the last time you were bored? I know I'm not that old, but I can remember a time when there was nothing to do, you couldn't whip out your phone and have everything to do. Where the idea of silence and solitude were not foreign concepts, because there were those moments, even when you were standing in line at the grocery store with nothing to do. Do you remember that? See, some of you don't. And which makes being a person of prayer extremely difficult, I think, because we have all this content, all these things, all these ideas constantly vying for our attention. And we wonder why we're always worried, and we wonder why we're always anxious, because we don't know what it is to be still and know that God is. Because I got to check my social feeds. I've got to check email because something important might be going on. We have all these things constantly vying for our attention, and we miss the most vital aspect of the human experience: a life lived in the presence of God. I actually think that's what prayer is, that prayer is the tangible reality of this. Prayer is the tangible reality of a life lived in the presence of God. You see, prayer helps us to be aware of the nearness of God in our ordinary living. And so this morning, I want to talk about, very briefly, two aspects of how we pray. So in Luke chapter 5, verse 16, we read this. But Jesus often withdrew to the wilderness for prayer. And as you look at the gospel accounts of the four stories, essentially, we have of Jesus' life, very regularly we see him sneaking off when no one is around to pray, to just be in the presence of God, his Father. He's got a lot to do, mind you. There are lots of people who need to be healed. There are lots of people who need to be fed. There are lots of lepers who need to be touched. There are lots of religious leaders who need to be taught true and pure religion. There's lots for Jesus to do as he's living in our place, on his way to the cross to take our guilt from sin and shame from being sinned against. And yet so often and regularly in his life, he sneaks away to be alone with God, this tangible reality of living in the presence of God, his Father. See, it was intentional. It was a time that was set apart. It was different than his ordinary rhythm of just going through life. He would sneak away. When's the last time you kind of sneaked away to be with God? No phone, no newspaper, however it is you get your anything. I mean, think about that. I mean, some of us, like, the idea of not having our phones, it's like, whew, I might miss something extremely important. And I went through this as a pastor. Well, if someone needs me. And so now, just a heads up, especially since I'm new to pastoring you, if you need me on Fridays, good luck. And I mean that with all love. I'm just not around my phone. I try to make it a habit now. It's part of my personal rhythm. I'm away from my phone, and I'll check it every now and then just in case there is an emergency and someone's in the hospital. I get that. But for the most part, I'm away from it on Fridays. How often do we do that? But not only do we see is prayer an intentional practice of being with God. That's what Jesus does. It's intentional. But also we see this, that prayer is a continuous practice of being with God. Paul says this to the church in Thessalonica, never stop praying. Well, that's hard. Man, Paul's just hitting us hard today. Be thankful in all circumstances. Now, don't miss this. Never stop praying, for this is God's will for you who belong to Christ Jesus. And I like how Eugene Peterson, who translated the message, he said it like this. Pray all the time. Thank God no matter what happens. This is the way God wants you who belong to Christ Jesus to live. But we're continually aware, even in our ordinary and mundane living, that God is with us. This may sound like this very theoretical, kind of out there, overly spiritualized idea, but I'm telling you, once we grasp this and we're in the messiness of our lives, of the bad diagnosis we get, or that person at work who's, we can't say those words on Sunday morning in the sanctuary. When we're in those moments and we learn to live this way, that we're continuously in the presence of God, which means God is with us and helping us love that person who's driving us crazy. That God is with us, and as we're suffering, we're reminded that Jesus embraced suffering on our behalf, and the author of Hebrews tells us he suffers right along with us. You see, this changes everything. It doesn't mean that life is going to be a bunch of, you know, rainbows and unicorns. No, it's better than that. It means that where we are in our lives, God is with us too. Brother Lawrence, he's one of my favorite monks from the 1600s. He said it like this. The most holy and important practice in the spiritual life is the presence of God. I love that. What's the most important spiritual practice? It's not doing anything. It's just the presence of God. That is, every moment to take great pleasure that God is with you. Now, this is prayer. And I think a lot of times we ask these questions like, okay, well, what do I say? Sometimes you don't have to say anything. You can just put your list away and just be with God, your Creator, who loves you and saves you and transforms you and recreates you into who He calls you to be. And when we live lives of prayer, when we live in the presence of God, look what happens. Paul tells us. We experience God's peace. This is what Paul says. Then you will experience God's peace. So don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. Then you will experience God's peace. I love this. Which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And I love how it exceeds anything we can understand. You see, God's peace is a peace that does not make sense to those outside of our faith. At least it shouldn't. It doesn't make sense. And yet this is the promise. I wasn't going to share this story, but I think I will because my mother's here. This is my mother, in case you didn't know. And my mother has taught me a lot as it pertains to faith and worry. And I'll never forget this time. So I am the firstborn child of my parents' two kids. I did everything right. As the good firstborn, right? Like, got a good job, got an apartment very early, I got married, had kids, you know, did all the right stuff. My sister, however, she has all sorts. She does everything not the right way, and we'll just leave it at that. I mean, according to our kind of cultural standards of the right way to do things and the not right way to do things. And she's a free spirit, we'll say. And when she was 16, she ran away from home to be a beach bum. She was going to live on the beach and do her own thing. And I'll never forget, you know, the police are at her house doing all the stuff. And the worry and the anxiety that should bring. But my mother, this woman of faith, who worry has never been part of how she's lived life. The whole time, just, we know that God is with us. We know that God is going to work and make things right. We've just got to wait. And that moment stuck with me. And so I had these other moments in my life where I think about what's going wrong. And I'm like, I always go back to that time. Like, well, if my mother can legitimately not let worry define her living in that moment. Wow, what faith. See, it's a peace that doesn't make sense. Now, she was okay that time. She came back. And she was homeless again for a little bit. Yeah, she. It's peace that doesn't make sense. And not only, though, will we experience God's peace when we live in God's presence through prayer, but look at the rest of the verse. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Now, guard our hearts and minds from what? I think it's God's peace guards our hearts and minds from living a life defined by worry and anxiety. But look at the stipulation. Don't miss this. As you live in Christ Jesus. You see, none of this works, nor does this make sense to those who are not in Christ Jesus. So how do we know if we're in Jesus? This term all throughout the New Testament. To be in Christ, participating with Christ. Well, Paul tells us to the church in Ephesus. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. God saved you by His grace which is something you don't deserve, right? Have I used the Disney World tickets analogy? Okay, folks, here's what grace is. What do you think of when you think of grace? See, it's something we don't deserve. So if I'm speeding right out here on the main road, I'm going 80 miles an hour, and the police officer pulls me over. See, I deserve something. I deserve a ticket. That's justice. Now, the police officer could, though, show me mercy and let me off the hook and just say, you know what? This time I'm going to let it go because you're really hungry. I know you had to get to Chick-fil-A. So we've always got some good excuse for why we're speeding, and the police officer buys it, and he or she says, I'm going to show you mercy and just let it go this time. See, here's what grace is, though. I deserve a ticket. In order for justice to be realized, I deserve a ticket and to pay for my wrongdoing. Mercy's letting me off the hook. Grace is the police officer saying, here's what you deserve. A speeding ticket, you're going to have to pay a fine. But instead of that, I'm giving you 4 tickets to Disney World to take your family. You see, that's grace. It's this gift that none of us deserve. And how are we saved? And that word saved, it literally means to be made whole, to be put back together, to be made right. Now, how do we do this? It's by grace. It's something you don't deserve. But it's when you believed. And Paul tells us, you can't take credit for this. It's a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for good things we have done, so that none of us can boast. So how do we get in Christ? We believe, as Martin Luther tells us. It's believing that what Jesus did on the cross, he did for you. That's faith. And when you're invited into the family, you're invited to live this life and this promise of peace. So this week, though, I want us, here's what I'm asking us all to do. Just this week, I want us all to set aside time to intentionally be in the presence of God. Without a phone, without Netflix going, you multitaskers always trying to throw things in there. No, with nothing on, where you get away. Maybe you take a stroll down the street. Maybe you sit on your couch with no TV and you pray. And if you don't know what to pray, you can take one of our bulletins home and pray the Lord's Prayer and then just sit. And I guarantee you, if we do that daily, your lives will be completely transformed. The simple act of living the way God created us to live, lives in His presence. So pick a time and pick a place and pray. And I really believe that if you do this every day, your worry and anxiety will start being replaced with God's peace that exceeds expectations. And so at this time, before we sing a hymn, actually, what time is it? Actually, let's just go ahead and close with a hymn. We're going to sing Be Thou My Vision. As we think about prayer and living life in the presence of God, and my hope is that this song would really capture our lives and hearts. It's 562 in the blue hymnals. And we'll sing 1, 2, and 4. I invite you to stand as we sing this morning. Oh, no, you go, Charles. You got it.
Save.
Amen. And as we close and respond to God's generous love for us, I invite you to recite our generosity creed, and then we will be dismissed. Holy Father, there is nothing I have that you have not given me. All I have and am belong to you. To spend everything on myself and to give without sacrifice is the way of the world that you cannot abide. But generosity is the way of those who call Jesus their Lord, love him with free hearts, serve him with renewed minds. Keep us invested in your kingdom and not in the systems of the world. I am determined to be generous because you, O God, are generous. And so on your way out, if you would like to be generous, if you this isn't your church home, please feel no obligation to give. But for those of you who call this home, the offering plate is here on your way out. And as you go, I do pray that God would guard you and guide you and keep you until we meet again. You are dismissed. Thank you.